I know, it's funny.
I still don't know.
Yes, they are.
Good afternoon. Glad to see you back here this afternoon in a busy week. This afternoon, we're looking at reaching a new generation. And you've heard me harp on the fact that there's quite a generational change that's taking place in our society. Part of that is due to digital media. I think there are other things as well that have happened in our society. But I think a lot of churches, a lot of local congregations feel a bit lost. Because it used to be that, you know, there was a youth group, and the youth went. And then when the youth stopped going, the church got a youth pastor, and the youth pastor got the youth to go. And now it seems that's a little rough sometimes, because of the fact that people growing up in our society are growing up in a very different society and hearing a lot of voices that I certainly did not hear when I was growing up. And frankly, a lot of churches have given up, and that's one of my real concerns. As I have visited declining congregations, I would say, now what do you have in terms of children and youth? And the very unapologetic answer often is, well, nothing, because they wouldn't come. No matter how many children or youth there are in the community. And so I think this is an important time this afternoon to think about how we reach that generation, because we're called to go and make disciples. We need to do that. Renée Embree is Director of Youth and Family Ministry for the Convention of Atlantic Baptist Churches. She's also an adjunct lecturer for us here, and really director in terms of the youth and family stuff, and she's teaching this week, so she is having nothing to do all week. And in the midst of that, she's coming to facilitate this group this afternoon, so we really appreciate that. And let me just say, Renée was one of my pastors, and she's a great leader in our convention, so just very thankful for her. Matt Snow had been at Birch Cove Baptist Church. He was stolen unapologetically recently, by RiverCross Church, and we're glad that Matt is willing to be part of this. Micah Linkletter is at Immanuel in Truro. Nancy Murphy at Brunswick Street in Fredericton, and Dan Pyke at Douglas. Is the church just barely out of Fredericton?
Just the
Fredericton city limit sign is here, and the church is there, I think. But Fredericton sign. Let's take time to pray as we begin this afternoon. Heavenly Father, we are thankful for the opportunities that we have to share good news with every generation. It is a changed world in which we live in many ways, in ways that sometimes boggle our minds. But nothing is a surprise to you. So we look to you for wisdom, and this afternoon, we look to you for guidance in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Steve. So yes, I'm part of the team at Convention of Atlantic Baptist Churches and also at Acadia Divinity College, imagining, dreaming, praying together about what revival looks like in Atlantic Canada today. And one of the ways we've been imagining that is asking the question, what does it look like to join God in changing Atlantic Canada neighborhood by neighborhood with the good news? And this afternoon, we are inviting you, our invitation to you is to ask, what is the voice of this generation, a generation of children and youth and young adults, saying to the church? What is the voice of this generation saying to the church? You know, God has often used youth and children to wake up God's people and call them to greater faithfulness. Think of Jeremiah and Daniel, Mary and Samuel and David. God has often used the voice of youth to call God's people to greater faithfulness. And so the question for us is, do we hear it? God often uses the courage of youth and children where adults are too afraid and too scared to do anything or try anything new. Right? Think of young David. Are we opened to hearing it? Open to God giving us fresh manna through this generation? And so, church, friends, are we letting youth use their courage to speak to us and call us to greater faithfulness today? Or are we subtly or not so subtly telling our youth and children to just stay in their cave, stay in their youth group on Sunday, stay in their hour of children's ministry, and keep to their cave? But Jesus says, don't hinder them. Let them come on to me. The kingdom belongs to such as these. God does, God has, God is using youth and children to renew his kingdom, to reveal his kingdom, to bring his kingdom. And this generation is telling us important things about what it means to be the church, what it means to be faithful to Jesus in this era. Now, sometimes, I must admit, with this generation, it can come across a little sarcastic, maybe a little critical, but can you hear underneath that how this generation is longing and has a deep desire for the church to wake up and be the church that God is calling us to be the people that God is calling us to be? They're looking to see, is this God really alive and active and relevant in our world today? And so as we go through this panel this afternoon, I invite you to listen for God's voice, to hear what God is saying through this generation to the church. I have some questions for our panelists, and then I'll open it up for questions from the floor, and then I've got some more questions for our panelists. So we'll keep them busy here this afternoon. My first question is, how have you seen youth and children's ministry bring new life to a congregation? So Matt, why don't you start with that one?
Hello, everyone. So I've been thinking about a few things about how I've seen new life in a congregation come from our children and our youth ministries. I have to admit, you know, like Dr. Steve already said, I'm new to RiverCross, and so everything there for me is new right now, but I'm just going to reflect on my experience. I've put in 5 years as a pastor and served in that way with youth in some capacity, and then years of, as a volunteer. But some of the attitudes that I think that can come out that bring new life through our children and youth ministries is that sometimes when our congregations get aware of what's happening with our children and with our youth, there's that like initial surprise, you know, oh, I had no idea that was happening with our youth, or I had no idea that they were doing that. And part of me kind of understands, and for good reason, you know, there's appreciation and support and encouragement in that kind of response to when the congregation hears about what our youth are doing. But then the other thing that I found challenging in that is that, well, maybe our youth ministry is not doing a good job, you know, communicating back to our congregation what we're doing and what we've been up to. And so as the congregation kind of gets more aware of what's happening, the ways that we're getting involved, the things that we're doing, you know, the faith commitments that are happening, the congregation really does get behind that and get excited and stirred up. And you know, how often have I heard, you know, oh, if only we could hear more about, you know, what our youth are doing and what they've been up to. So I think that's one real way that I've been kind of challenged in that.
So what are some of the ways you share stories from what's happening in youth and children's ministry in the wider church so that they get to hear the new life that's coming? What are some of the ways?
Okay. Well, I guess the two ways that I think of off the top of my head would be, maybe we're just reporting back on a Sunday morning. We're sharing pictures and kind of having the youth kind of describe for themselves the experiences that they had. And actually, that's where I find that response happening most often, is because when the youth are sharing and the youth are giving it their own perspective about what's happening, some of the surprise in the congregation is, oh, I had no idea, you know, little Timmy is grown up now and doing that. Or I was completely unaware of the life change that's happening in our young people. And so when they're presenting on a Sunday morning, but the other way also that the congregation can get more informed is that when the youth are literally biting off more than they can chew, so that they need the congregation's support and getting behind them and getting involved in such a way that if it won't happen unless the rest of the congregation is getting involved. And I guess, yeah.
Excellent. Thank you, Matt. Nancy, why don't you tell us a little bit about your role and context to start us?
Right. I'm the Associate Pastor to Children at Brunswick Street in Fredericton, but I also do some street outreach as well. So I oftentimes, those two cross over quite a bit. I've been there for almost 11 years, and my role, again, is usually with children. On Sunday morning, we have a worship service for our children, so if you come to visit, normally I wouldn't see you, because we have a phrase that we believe in. It says, let kids worship like kids. And so we give them that opportunity to have all the same elements that you would have in adult worship. We just do them a little bit more fun. maybe a little bit louder than you might be used to, but yeah, that's where I am.
Excellent. So what would you say the voice of this generation of youth and children is saying to the church?
Perfect. I think they have lots that is kind of happening and brewing there. The first thing, I've already griped once to our panel, and I'm just going to put it out there, is one phrase that I hate is when we talk about this generation being, they're the next generation of our church. They're not. They're here, they're today, they're part of our church, and they're our church family. So let's not say, oh, they're coming up. Yeah, they are. They're growing. But they have value. They have an important role to play today in our church. They have an important role of how they see the world. They can give us ideas. God speaks through children and uses them so much that he can lead your church. Let the children lead. And how many children have led their parents to the Lord because of their questions, because they wanted to know more? How many have these children constantly make me think, right? Often I put God in the box. Oh, God can't do that. I'm surprised when God answers prayer sometimes. But these kids are like, what do you mean? Of course he did. We prayed. God hears. He answers. You know, they're here to say, we're a part of this family. We're here today. Don't just put us in a box and say, we'll talk to you in 10 or 15 years. We're here today. We're valuable. And I think they want to know what's real. They want to know what real faith looks like. They don't want you to be fake. Kids can eat you up and spit you out. And they will. They want to know, they want you to be real, and if you are, and you can honestly say, I don't really know, or you share some of the struggles that you're going through, that's what they want. They want you to be real. They want to see your faith in action. They want to know that you're working this all out, that you don't have it figured out, and that you're on this journey too. They want to see a real faith in action. I also think they are looking at this world, and they want to see how God can make a difference. And they know, and we teach them the stories, and we teach them. But then oftentimes, as Danny was preaching this morning, we kind of lose our perspective on God. These kids haven't, and they see who God is and how amazing he is and the power that he has, but we oftentimes don't listen to them. And they're here to say, we gotta look up.
Mm, wonderful, such wonderful advice. Dan, tell us a little bit about your context.
Sure. I'm the youth and children's pastor at Douglas Baptist Church, which is on the north side of Fredericton. And like Steve said, we're just on the outskirts of the city. So we're part of our identity, it's unique. We've got a number of people that I think would still see us as a rural church. But we've definitely been affected by the, I guess, city sprawl sort of entry into our community. And so for most of our people, we're really just a part of the suburbs of Fredericton. But it's a great identity, and so I've been there for about getting close to 5 years.
Excellent. So as we seek revival in Atlantic Canada, why do we need to pay attention to the voice of children?
Yeah, I think it starts with recognizing that it's biblical. I mean, we see this example in scripture of the generations interacting back and forth in a number of different ways. one of my go-to passages is often Psalm 78, where it talks about the generations passing on the stories of our faith from one to the next. And I think as part of any good storytelling experience, there's opportunity for the recipients of the stories to be asking questions. And so there's that engagement. And so it's not just about us imparting doctrine to our kids, but it's about enabling them to interact with the truths and stories and to hear it and to reinterpret it for their context. I think the other thing too is we're living in a culture that is increasingly geared towards our youth and children. And so from the perspective of advertising and marketing, billions of dollars is spent in advertising towards our youth and our children, recognizing that in a lot of ways they control the pocketbooks of the parents, whether or not the parents want to admit it. And so they're in a prime position to interpret this changing culture for us, because it's changing at a rapid pace, and they're living through changes even more so than any of us on the panel are. So they're there to help us interpret those changes and to walk through them with us.
That's excellent. Let them be our teachers of our culture. Mm-hmm. So how do we pay attention to the voice of the children?
Yeah. Giving them opportunity to ask questions. I mean, that's a key feature of this generation, is that they want to be able to ask questions and have their voices heard. So something that I tried after visiting Micah's church back last year, I tried in the fall when I was preaching a sermon to the congregation, I had my cell number up on the slides and took some questions afterwards. And great engagement from my middle school students, high school students, young adults, the whole spectrum of the congregation. Wide range of questions, some of them very relevant to what I was speaking about, others not at all. But it was still a place for them to ask their questions and to engage. I have a Bible study for our high school students that we meet in our house on Wednesday nights, and that's a place for them to ask questions. And so oftentimes they're asking questions about church and why we do things, and you know, why do these people serve communion and why don't other people? Some of those questions, but it's also a chance for us to study scripture together, and I love reading through passages of scripture and hearing their voices and their perspectives on that, and then oftentimes I try to share that, whether it's through social media or in stories with our congregation, just allowing them to hear our students' perspectives on scriptures and on our faith.
Excellent. Thank you very much. Micah, tell us a little bit about your role in context.
Afternoon, folks. My name is Micah. I do hang out at a spot called Immanuel Baptist in Truro, most days of the week anyway. I've been there about, my wife and I on the drive realized that last week was our 11th anniversary. We closed out 11. We're working on the 12th year. Is that the right term? That's the master's degree coming up right there. And over the last number of years, I've worn a few different hats. I guess officially right now my job title is pastor of children's, youth, young, adult, and associate ministries, which it gives me free rein to do pretty much anything I'm interested in. So yeah, that's where I'm at, and that's what I do.
Wonderful. One of the great potentials of youth ministry is to reimagine some new ways of church, of doing church, of being church. And so on behalf of the wider church, the wider community, reimagining what it can look like. So give us some thoughts, Micah, on how youth and children's ministry is reimagining church.
Right. So the first thing that, if my answer is going to make sense, you're going to have to believe the thing I'm about to say to you. The first thing we really need to realize about youth ministry is that it's much closer to missions work than we might like to acknowledge. When we send people overseas in your quintessential missionary type role, it's because there's a people who speak a different language, who live a different way, with different values, who need to hear the gospel. And our youth ministries is to a group of people who think different, live different, speak a different language, it seems like, and they need to hear the gospel in a way that they understand it. The difference with this particular missions field is that it will eventually subsume the culture that it's existing alongside of. Nancy's absolutely right when she says the youth and the children are the church of today, but they really are also the church of the future. The culture that is emerging there is going to someday replace the culture that we live in now, and it's always been that way. The worship wars broke out because a generation of people who had a particular value of music started to integrate with another culture that looked at it a different way. And that started in youth ministries. Small group ministry and house church ministry started within youth ministries with a generation of people who loved gathering together in smaller, closer knit. And as they moved into the wider church body, that became part of our larger ministry. And I think what we're beginning to see in just very practical terms, at least in the area I hang out in right now, is this drive towards the practical outworkings of our faith within our local community or local missions. You know, if your faith doesn't change how you respond to a single mom without food in the cupboard, then your faith is irrelevant, is in many ways the heartbeat of the generation that I work with. And so that's one way that they're beginning to reimagine what it looks like to do church. It's not that it's different. It's not that it's a generation saying to the generation before what you did is wrong. It's church that is next. It's what's working out next. You know, another practical aspect is how they look at how we treat each other. Mm-hmm. You know, they're one of the first generations that have grown up with a really practical view of the devastation that broken relationships yields. And so if they see us treating each other wrong, then they assume that our gospel, our salvation, means nothing. Because how can you serve a God that came to die for us and yet treat each other wrong? So it's not that they say that church needs to be reimagined, but it's the flavor of the culture that changes the church that it's integrating with.
In so many ways, they say, show me. You tell me this Jesus is real and makes a difference. You know, show me the difference he's made in your relationships, and how you live, in our neighborhood.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think every generation has said that to the generation before. It's just that they're saying it in a way that we didn't expect, because they're of a different generation.
Absolutely. Very helpful. And so a similar question for you, Dan, in a similar way, sometimes in youth, and children's ministry, we have more permission to experiment. We can do some research and development for the rest of the church and try some experiments about new ways to build relationships, new ways to explain the faith, new methods, new styles, perhaps with music, perhaps in other ways. So what experiments are you trying with youth and children, and what can the wider church learn from those experiments?
Yeah, one of the experiments that we did, say we're still experimenting with it, but it's been probably about 3 years, and it affects the whole church. We came to a point with volunteers where we were trying to run our different streams of children's ministry, and we're just coming up short with the number of volunteers that were required, and so we started, dismantling Sunday school and wrestling through that. And so one of the things that came out of that is once a month now we gather together as an entire church body to have breakfast before the service. We call it the dooryard. We try to make it more than just having breakfast, but we try to do some intergenerational teaching and bringing people together. What we find also happening is that we've got these round tables in our church gym that we set up, but what of course happens is that people come in and they sit with their friends, and actually what I find is that our seniors and our senior youth are probably the two worst groups for staying together at a table. So what we've started doing is forcing them to shuffle, and so we've done different things. One time we had a global missions focus, and so we passed everyone a flag as they came into the gym, and then probably through the time together we said, okay, everyone who has a flag of Kenya, they need to sit at a table together. Everyone who's got a flag of Bolivia needs to sit at a table together. And so from there we will pose some questions to the table and force them to interact around the table. But it's just a chance for our adults to hear the voices of our youth and children, but also for our youth and children to hear the voices of the adults and all generations. So that's been an experiment that has been working really well, and there's been some neat stuff that has come out of that.
I think it's a reminder to us, too, to not be afraid to let youth and children try some experiments and learn from them, from the experiments they're doing. So thank you. Matt, next question's for you. So Micah reminded us that this generation, we have to be missionaries and learn their culture and their ways of communicating. And of course, we know in today's world, a large way they communicate is through social media and Twitter and Facebook and using hashtags and all kinds of things. And so to speak to us a bit about the value of engaging a community online and in social media and how we do that well.
Well, we've heard a lot already this week about how our online presence really is important in communicating not just who we are, but communicating the gospel, you know, speaking their language. You know, we heard that, you know, cell phones kind of can be an extension of somebody. It's not just this object they carry around, but an extension of themselves and part of who they are and how they interact. And that could very well be true. And whether it is or not, the reality is that we are bombarded with messages all of the time from all kinds of different places. You know, if you have a website or if you're using Facebook to promote your ministries, a lot of people, you know, they literally could be a click or, you know, 3 millimeters on a screen from, you know, come to youth group and we're going to talk about the importance of Jesus to, you know, who knows what. You know, and so the constant bombardment of different messages, of all kinds of different things. And then also, you know, we're the Google it generation. If we don't know something, you know, all of us are gonna go to Google if we need to figure something out. We did our senior high Bible study this week, so just a few days ago, and we were doing the story of Samson, and then one of our grade 12 students said, wait a second, there's lions in Israel? You know, we get the story of Samson, you know, ripping apart the lion, and everybody's heads went down. You know, they Googled it. You know, are there lions in Israel? and you know, they went to the internet to try to find, you know, that kind of an interesting thing. So I think the encouragement for us is to create those places online and the extension of ourselves. We can speak into those messages and the things that they're seeing. And I find sometimes our youth, and children and young people, as often as they spend on the phone and, you know, as often as they're kind of filtering through those messages, sometimes it may not feel like they're interacting with some of the things that we're trying to interact with. You know, maybe they're not responding or they're not commenting on, you know, some of the things, the materials that we're providing, but they're still getting read and they're still getting looked at. And we just don't know exactly how those seeds might be planted, but hopefully that we're hopefully, you know, using and sharing content that we've seen ourselves and encouraging people to see. So I think that's one important thing. The other thing too, and thinking about how our churches can kind of reach our community through our online presence, is you know, there are all kinds of different community groups, and you know, each and a lot of different neighborhoods actually have their own kind of community gathering online. So whether it's like a Facebook group or a website or different places where communities are just, you know, gathering online and helping people know about things, maybe it's yard sales or you know, school cancellations or whatever. There's places that I think our churches need to be interacting with. You know, not just pumping out content, which is great, but also interacting with other communities that are commenting and sharing online. A couple of cautions that I guess I had would be to just as people are online, when people are interacting with whatever online content you're sharing, maybe it's Facebook or website, Twitter, whatever, you know, the community notices when it's out of date, you know, when March break is coming up and they're still getting invitations to Christmas, or, you know, they notice that, and I think it indirectly communicates a message that we're not intending to communicate, and so I think it's important to kind of be current and be up to date, and then of course just the reminder in our own our own witness and the way that we conduct ourselves online is an important thing as well, because we can model healthy use of online media, and of course, you know, the content that we're looking through and the opinions we're posting really are public, as often as we tend to think they're not as public as we are, as they are, as we think they are.
So where are youth online these days? Are they still on Facebook, or where are they?
well, I should start by saying that no matter what I mention, as soon as I mention it, it's not cool anymore.
As soon as we know about it, it's out of date.
I would say if I needed to get a hold of a youth today, and it had to be through some kind of digital form, it would be their cell, their mobile cell text messaging. There are Facebook accounts, and then Twitter. If you're not sure about what Twitter is, it's just like a mini Facebook. You can post whatever you want in 140 characters or less. And if that's still too long for you, there's Instagram, where you can just take a picture. And there's all kinds of different things. Your phone is full of online connecting opportunities.
I just heard someone call out Snapchat. That's another one.
Right.
Instant.
Ready?
Micah, you
want to? Well, I was just going to say, and Matt, I think everything you said is just bang on, but one of the things we're learning is that what you said about their phones is exactly correct. That's a primary way to reach them, is to text them or to call them that way. And at least in my life, and you can check me if I'm wrong, please, by the time I figured out how to work the latest thing and then thought through the theological implications of it, and then the logistics of it, it's already gone, right? So if you love learning how to work Instagram, and that's a wonderful hobby, then yeah, run into that. But don't feel like you need to learn how to set up a Facebook group to connect with a team. Call them or text them and go and see them.
Yeah, absolutely.
And how about online presence for our own renewal and equipping as leaders?
Oh yeah. If I were to do my education over again, I did just move recently, and because I started at RiverCross before our physical move actually happened, so we ended up hiring movers to take care of all of that. So I arrived at the old house when the movers arrived, and all of my books were there. And as the many trips up and down the stairs and onto the trucks, some of the movers were grumbling, "Oh, this guy should have invested in ebooks." So the access I have to information through digital media is phenomenal. I can buy my textbooks and read them from a screen if I wanted to. There are all kinds of authors and people who blog and write regularly, and websites galore of fantastic content. And there's some not so fantastic content too, but there's just a wealth of resources there. So I guess I would like to maybe suggest two resources for you if you're wondering where to start. Some places that if you're looking to kind of get youth involvement and kind of how do we do that missionally, the two places I would recommend to go first would be to a website that a bunch of Atlantic Canadian bloggers are doing. It's called oneneighborhood.org. And it's spelled the Canadian way, so oneneighborhood.org, and that's a really helpful, some really helpful material in there. I think you all agree, maybe, especially Renée. The other place, if you do have a Facebook account, or if you're wondering how to kind of get connected through that way, just in the top on your Facebook page, there's a search bar, and type in the search bar Atlantic Canadian Youth Workers, or Atlantic Canadian Children's Ministry Workers, and find that community there, and there'll be hundreds of people in those groups who are sharing resources and materials and suggestions all the time. So mm-hmm. I'd start there.
Yeah, and that's a great Facebook group. People will ask questions like, what's a curriculum that I can use for children that helps them think about their world? And then all kinds of people will respond and what they found really helpful and good. And so you can ask your questions there and engage. So I have lots more questions for the panel, but maybe some of your thinking has been stirred by what they've shared already. So I want to open it up and give you an opportunity to ask your questions of the panel before I keep asking why. So, just give me a wave and I'll bring the microphone to you if you have a question.
I was quite taken by, Matt, your comment that when you tell a story and you find some interesting information, that your first response is to go to the internet to find out whether that is accurate information. And so it just dawned on me just now that we verify the truth of Scripture by going to Wikipedia. And my question is Wikipedia now the basic source from which we get, the primary source from which we get authentication for God's Word? I say that humorously, but the point still is that's where they're going for their verifying information. Are there tools that you recommend that we send our youth to get affirmation for the truth you are teaching them?
Great question. Who wants to handle that one?
I've tried that. Okay. So I'm going to go on my phone here, and you don't need a mobile phone to access some of these resources. And I just have a Jesus category, and I pull that up.
He does too.
I guess first of all, there are so many digital apps and programs that you can use just to access your Bible, and so by far that would be by the first place you can go. You can download one called YouVersion. There's a Faith Life Study Bible. There's Glow Bible. I even have Bible for Kids, and a lot of those applications will actually have kind of in-depth commentaries attached to them, and you know, so if I went to the story about Samson, there could very well be a link that would take them into a deeper study about maybe geographical context or timelines or whatever. So I would say I would start there, and to use the resources that your Bible apps often come complementary with those places. I would not recommend starting with Wikipedia. Yeah, you're right. I think that's where I would start. There's websites called Reasonable Faith, which is kind of more apologetic. There's a website called In Doubt, and that's one that is youth ministry focused and helps them wrestle with questions of faith.
Thank you, Matt. Other questions from the floor?
So this is a topic that I'm working through now with John Dixon, who's the youth pastor of my church. And so I just wanted to get some feedback on what you guys do in your context. Because the reality is that you are with them from 1 to 3 hours a week, and I'm with them the rest of the time. And so what are you doing, and what have you been experimenting with to actually equip the parents of your youth to be the disciples of their children?
Great question. What's this?
That's a hard question. I mean, and that's something that I've been struggling with and trying to answer that too. I do try to communicate regularly with my parents about things that are coming up, both in youth ministry and in children's ministry. And so often, what I'll do along with those emails, I might send them a link to an article or to resource that I've stumbled across, just as a way to maybe help point them towards some places where they can ask some questions and get some information. And so I see part of what I do is just to be able to be a resource gatherer for our families, and to try to point them towards those resources too.
So
I think a lot of it's communication and realizing that just helping parents connect together, because something that you've gone through, somebody else may be going through, and be able to share some of that light. About 4.5 months ago, I'm single, I don't have any family, so 4.5 months ago I took in 2 foster children, and what I realized is I know nothing about anything. In a lot of ways, but it's given me a new perspective on what it is to be a parent, and to be a parent to raise children that you want to love God and to serve Him. And the best thing I can do is connect with other parents, and for me as a children's pastor is to connect people together, older people and younger people who can learn together, recognizing that as a pastor, whether I have kids or not, I don't have the answers, but I can support you and I can encourage you, and we can encourage one another together as one body.
That's great, great advice.
This has a lot to do with Danny's question, and I thank you, Danny, for asking that when it comes to involving parents. Nancy, you had mentioned that you had seen, you had mentioned that you had witnessed youth or even children and youth as a sort of an influence to lead parents to the Lord as well, which I think is amazing. I was wondering if you might be able to share maybe like one or two stories of that happening, and if so, and you know, on the same note, what our job as youth pastors is to equip the parents to be able to sort of support their children in their faith.
Even if the parents are Christian.
Even if the parents aren't, especially if the parents aren't Christian.
I think one of our first jobs is creating a place, a family, an environment that children are welcome, and that parents who don't know the Lord, if they see quality, they're going to want to be involved. And a lot of people who may not go to church, they may have gone as a younger person, and they see a value in that. My kids should go. So if we create an environment that is healthy, that is welcoming to children, then those parents are going to bring their children. And as you engage their children, as you love them, as you disciple them, and their kids go home and talk, kids share lots of things. Like, I hear all the time of the fight that mom and dad had before church on Sunday morning, right? So we know what they tell us, so what are they gonna go home and tell them, right? So they are an open book. They share all of those things. And so we need to just to create an environment that they're welcome and that they can ask those questions and they receive that support. I think mentoring is a good thing. It's an awesome thing for children who may not have a mom and dad who love the Lord. And to pair them up with older adults that can pour into their life, that can love them, that can really show them who God is and the difference that He makes in my everyday life. And so kids can come to church, and they're the ones who can get them up in the morning. Like, if they want to go somewhere bad enough, they're the ones who say, Mom and Dad, they're the ones who dictate the pocketbooks. They also dictate the schedules. If I don't want to go to hockey anymore, they don't go to hockey anymore. But if I want to go somewhere bad enough, my mom and dad are probably going to take me. And if we create an environment then that we engage those parents when they come in, if I see them coming in, I'm like, oh, hallelujah, here they are. It's not, oh, wow, it's about time you got here that we talked about last night. You know, it's a welcoming thing, and we encourage them, and we build a relationship, right? It's all about a relationship and connecting with them.
Thank you so much. Yeah, children bring their parents to the Lord. Other questions from the floor?
Just a follow-up to what the first question from the floor was. I've been reading a lot about the development of oral tradition. And one of the things of making truth in an oral tradition was just check against the community. The community heard the stories, and they said, no, you're not telling it right. Tell it the way it was supposed to be told. And our youth, I think, have that capability now on a global scale. They check it against the community. And is that something you're seeing, and how is that playing out?
Yeah, in the same way that, you know, if a kid was to reference a bad article for their paper, they'd be docked in school, right? They're learning whether or not the crap that they're finding on the internet is worthwhile or is just garbage. And so we don't need to be terrified of them searching, hey, is that, were there lions in Israel? Because they're developing the skills to actually double check and recheck that. And frankly, it's probably not a bad thing to have some fact checkers around some pastors. Some of my stories may not be 100% grounded in reality. And so to have a few kids around that keep calling me back to the truth is healthy for my soul.
I'm ministerial. Steve mentioned we have sadly no news. Only a couple of kids now. What does that mean? But I'm in ministerial where one of the other pastors, he's a high school group that meets at the school a few times, and he said that you can take certain discussions so far in terms of social issues, things that are learning at school and how to learn, but if you take them too far, they're just gone. They'll just turn around and be. And so, how do you probably know the areas I'm talking about? So how do you handle that as you know, as youth pastors, as youth workers, and also for we who are not and just interact with youth on a regular basis?
For me, and I'll let these guys speak the truth. I want to make sure that I get the gospel first. You know, it used to be when I started in youth ministry, we had this problem with kids swearing in the church. If only that was our issues now. And the response was, well, they don't know Jesus. Why would you expect them to behave like Christ followers? Not that I want to take that to the nth degree beyond what the gospel supports, but I want to make sure that the kids I'm working with walk with Christ. And then as they get to that point, I want to call them to make him king of their life and to keep taking the things that they feel and checking against what he taught and what he teaches and what the Holy Spirit leads them, and to keep making their agenda subservient to his. And so that may mean that, you know, the hot topic issues that we would love to be at the fore actually come in somewhere near the rear, because the first priority is, do they love Jesus? Is he king? And then everything else kind of falls in with that. Now, that can't be used as an excuse never to deal with issues, but that would be the first filter that I try and run things through. And I'm sure I'm wrong.
Yeah, and I think it starts even before youth too, and just grounding our kids in the story of Scripture, the story of Christ, and even as we're teaching our children, it's pointing everything back to Jesus, so they start to become grounded in the rich story of our faith. And even as we're talking about Old Testament stories, it's pointing them to Jesus and saying the story points us ahead to who Jesus is. So that as they become familiar with the story, as they start to wrestle with what does it look like for Jesus to be king over my life, that starts at a young age.
That starts at a young age, and getting the kids to understand who Jesus is and how he is king of their life. As a dad with young kids, I mean, I see my kids, I'm challenging my own children with that question too. And so they become grounded in who Christ is, and that is, as our children become teenagers, as they wrestle through the questions of social issues, it starts with the grounding in who Jesus is. I mean, and that's obviously with our church kids, and so what that looks like with our community kids, it's still, like Micah said, I think we have to start with Jesus and go from there.
What you're saying reminds me of something I've heard many people say now, but it used to be in our communities that first folks had to behave, do the kind of things that Christian communities do and look like us before they would believe and then before they would belong. And so, you know, the old adage, they had to, don't smoke, don't chew, and go with girls that do. They had to behave first, and then they could, then they hopefully came to belief in Jesus, and then they belong, or be first, and they had to behave, and then they belong, truly belong to the community. Where today, it's completely switched. People need to know that even if their behavior is far from Christ at this point, can they belong? Can they belong in our communities? Can they belong in our youth groups, our churches, our children's ministry? And then hopefully through that, come to believe. And then, and only then, does their behavior start to line up with Christ. Questions for both of you?
I have a two-pronged question for you, Clive. folks there, recognizing that we have a variety of sizes of churches represented here, a variety of communities represented here. And when I think of all of your churches, I think we're probably looking at a larger and more maritime province. Okay, so these questions come from that recognition. The first one is, for those that are here wondering, well, where do I begin? We have nothing. That's one question. The second question is that some of us have some ministries, great ministries maybe going, but recognizing, for lack of a better word, there's a hole in our ministry. Where do I start? I can't do everything, the person may be saying, the pastor may be saying. Where do I begin in trying to pull that together? So there's two questions for you.
Great questions. Laura, you're getting to our questions before we can get to them. I think the first thing that we've already talked about is making sure we create an environment where they're welcome, that we recognize that they are not an important part of our future, they're an important part of our today. And let's start there. Recognizing that not everybody can do everything, and we don't want to. But let's make sure that our children and our youth in our church, but also in the community around our church, knows that, no, you may not have a youth pastor, you may be a smaller church, that's okay, but do they have a place to come? Do they have a place there? Are you involved in their community? You have lots of people who are amazing. If you are in a small rural church, there's Teacher Appreciation Week. Are you involved in that? Can you go and appreciate your teachers, and so that those youth see that church as a valuable thing? Like, oh, who are these people? Are you out and involved in the community? Do you have a gym that you could open up to say, hey, let's have ball hockey or volleyball or basketball or some kind of league, that you open it up? And that doesn't have to be a pastor going. That can be somebody who may used to be a teacher and used to coach basketball. They can come along. Or do you have an opportunity to open your church because you have retired teachers who could offer tutoring after school? All those kinds of things. But making sure that they know that there's a place to come. And you don't have to start with trying to find a youth pastor and do these big, grand, and glorious events. Those are all great. But it starts really small, first recognizing that they're important and you want to listen to them. And let them play a role. Give them responsibilities. Give them opportunities to serve, to learn. I know for myself as a youth, I was given opportunities to serve in the church. That's where I learned, and I learned the things that God had gifted me and the things that he definitely didn't. But I had those opportunities, and that's where I felt God calling me into the ministry, because I had opportunities to fall on my face, but I had a church family that was there to go, that's okay, let's pick it up and let's keep going. And I had somebody to mentor me. And I think that's some of what we can do, whether you're a ginormous church or whether you're a little church, but be welcoming and open.
Good word, welcoming and open. So sometimes youth ministry has been siloed from the wider church, both in large churches with multi-staff. Sometimes the youth ministry is off on its own, doing its own thing. But I've seen this in small churches as well, where the couple volunteers that do the youth group on Wednesday night feel very much on their own and siloed from the wider church. And so what's the correction for this? How do we be a community together? Micah, why don't you start us off?
Yeah, sure. I'm just trying to remember some of the thoughts. Frankly, being in a smaller church, kind of the issues that you were raising, makes it in some ways easier to avoid that siloing effect. Because, well, you know, the youth pastor's there and he's got a team, or she's got a team of volunteers, and they're going to meet on these nights, and they're going to keep busy, and then all of a sudden the children or the youth are off by themselves and they're never seen. The correction to that, and I think even our larger churches, especially the way I do ministry, needs to hear this, is to bring our students into our everyday life. And yeah, there's got to be safeties and precautions around that because of the age we live in. But frankly, if you're in a smaller church, there's a good chance that the team that you want to minister is related to you somehow. And so you can, at least in the maritime set, I don't mean that in a nasty way, I just mean that in my own experience. You know, my nephew goes to the church, so I pick him up and I go, not literally, but my, you know, at some point in the future, my nephews will be going to the church. I take them out for coffee or McDonald's. my lead pastor and I, and a few others in the church, we do a podcast. We were just talking this last week about, you know, sometimes there's rotten jobs that need to be done around the church. And the thing is that, yeah, we can invite them alongside us as we do those things, but they can't just be delegated to the teens, right? This is going down a bunny trail. But I got a phone call this week from a lady who was totally snowed in, and she called her church asking for help, and they said, call Immanuel, they've got a youth group, they might send some teens to dig you out. And you know, this idea that the teens are only there for manual labor isn't the correction to the siloing. It's, hey, this lady needs to be dug out, and I'm going to grab little Johnny or little Timmy, and we're going to do it together. And we're going to dig them out, and yeah, we'll probably grab coffee afterwards. Or we're going to fix the leaking toilet, or we do life together. And every teen needs Christian adults in their life that are showing them how to do that. And that has a pretty good way of breaking down the silence, because honestly, we still need to do ministry in a way they understand. But we also need to do life together.
Thank you very much. Anyone want to add to that question?
Please.
No? Okay, we'll go on to the next one. So how do we help the generations understand each other? Matt, why don't you start us on that one?
I just have, two suggestions kind of from my own learning experience. Yesterday we were talking about church structure and church government. And I was probably 3 years into my first ministry experience before I realized that our church's structure and our church's government can be a huge asset for me. And I think one thing that I've learned is that when our church's structure is confusing, for people who don't know that structure, it can seem like a barrier to ministry. It can seem like that thing that you have, that obstacle that you can't overcome. I would suggest, you know, to a pastor, to somebody in the church, you know, what if it wouldn't be really cool if we tried, you know, this ministry in this way? And my response would be, oh, you'd have to make a motion to do that. Okay, how about this one? You know, I had no idea what it meant, you know? I think a huge opportunity is there to invest into our leaders to help them come alongside and understand how churches make decisions and just how, what kind of an asset your finance committee can be when you're trying to fundraise for an opportunity or whatever church structure that you have. I think that's one thing that kind of maybe not, you know, flashy or special or anything like that, but I think it's really, really important, you know, when we have an opportunity to build bridges between the generations, when we're investing into those leaders who want to make those decisions and want to invest. I think that's one way, is to help them understand what kind of resources are available to them. And the other thing, I guess, kind of more from the parenting perspective, about how we can listen to each other. One thing that I communicate to parents about why our youth ministry exists is that I would hope that our youth ministry at its very best can be a supporting tool that you use as you see your children grow up and become successful and to be the Jesus-following people that you would like them to be. And so I guess we say that we are a supporting tool for you to use as you see your children grow up. And as children are getting older and as they develop into teenagers, although parenting and parents are still the primary influence in a child's life, their circle of influence gets wider. And I see an opportunity for our churches to be those people who are there as that circle of influence gets wider and as more people are investing into the lives of our young people. Our youth ministry can be the people who are making sure, like Micah was saying, that we have Christian adults investing and mentoring and coming alongside our young people and sharing back and forth. There's people in this room who have decades of youth ministry experience and I've learned so much from. But on the other hand, the other group of people that I've learned so much from about youth ministry are the youth themselves, right? And I think those would be what I would say.
Yeah. And there's some education that needs to go on there to understand each other and the different generations, and it does take humility to understand one another. So let me throw out a scenario. Say I'm from a small rural church, and somewhere in Atlantic Canada, might be hard to imagine, I know, somewhere in Atlantic Canada, and I am the only person that does ministry to children, and it tends to be two children from the same family that come every Sunday, and I just take them out during the sermon and try to teach them something. What encouragement, what next steps would you have for me, or what is my goal in that?
Sure. I grew up in a church like that, and so the two kids were my sister and I. And those people that invested in our lives, I mean, and of course, being in a smaller church, it was often my mother as well, but there were other people too. And when I look back to God leading me into ministry and these experiences, those saints are a huge part of that story. And so they were an encouragement to my sister and me, and praying for us and asking us about life. And from the time that we were very young kids, they were investing in our lives. And so I think a big testimony to the fact that I'm a pastor and my sister is still following the Lord is due to those saints that were, I mean, my parents, probably after my sister and me, were the youngest people in the church. And so, I mean, they were just people that loved on us. And so do that, just love on the kids and invest in their lives and just make sure they know that they're important.
Yeah, and don't underestimate how valuable that is. One life or two lives. Yeah. So as we've been talking, we've been highlighting that this is a generation that is especially looking for evidence, the evidence that God's kingdom is breaking in, that they can see the difference it's making. So in children's ministry and youth ministry, how do we do that?
I mean, it's just so important that our kids and our youth recognize that their role is not just to come to church with their parents, but how do we be this good news in our community? And I mean, that comes in all kinds of different ways. As you get to know your community, as you get to know your kids, some things that we've done, we've started kind of forming a loose partnership with the food bank in Greener Village in Fredericton, and so we found a number of ways to support them and to raise awareness of that ministry in our city. And so for a week every summer for the last 3 or 4 years, myself and the Anglican youth pastor on the north side, we've been taking a group of our students and kids and families, whoever wants to come with us, we just spend a week out there. They bought an old greenhouse property a number of years ago, and so they've been working on planting gardens and reestablishing greenhouses, and so we've been able to do a lot of the grunt work for them. It's been a great way to just encourage them and build that partnership. We do a food drive on Halloween as well. Part of in our church, there's often a question, what do we do with Halloween? And so part of the way of answering that has been to go into our community and do a food drive for Greener Village. I did a youth event in the fall and invited other youth groups to come and spend an afternoon there. So that's been an organization that we've supported our kids in Sunday morning ministries. After we teach the story, we do some application activities, and so there's been a few times where those activities have been they may be producing soup mix bags, and so I'll have all the soup mix ingredients laid out on the table. The kids come along with measuring cups and pour them into a paper bag, and then we deliver those to the food bank so they can pass them to their clients. And so it's been about partnering with an organization that's already doing great work, and just trying to find ways to bless and teach our kids that it's the world's bigger than them, and they're not necessarily the center of the world, and finding ways to raise awareness.
And as we do that, as we see this heart in this generation that wants to serve, and we find ways to help them serve, how do we also help them not just turn that into good works, and that it's the gospel connection to that?
Yeah, I mean, it's teaching them the stories of Jesus and helping them realize the ways that Jesus taught, but he spent so much time with people and meeting their needs, and teaching them this is what it is to be church, is to meet the needs in our community and to reach out to the people around us. And I think our kids and our youth have so much to teach us because they have the passion and desire to do that. And so we can build from their passion and, you know, share the stories with our congregation of what our kids and youth are doing. And that raises excitement and just real desire among others in our congregation to want to be involved in similar projects too. But it's bringing it back to Jesus and connecting these actions with Christ.
Thank you. So Micah, give us some really practical advice on how we can help youth and children be involved in the wider church, so on Sunday morning or leadership things.
I guess we'd have to start with the question, why do we want them there? Right? And if the heartbeat is, well, so that our doors don't close, that may be the wrong idea. And if it's, well, we don't want to lose our kids, that's, you know, I totally resonate with that, but it's also the wrong motivation. If we want our students, I need to start that sentence over again. The goal is to see young people servants of the kingdom, right? Like that's the goal. We want our students and our neighbors' kids and our own children to become servants of the king. And if that's the case, then we ourselves need to continue to become more missional in what we're doing. If our doors are open so that we can see our friends every Sunday morning over a cup of reasonably decent coffee, you know, that's not a terrible reason, but it's not the kingdom reason. And so we need to start pointing our kids towards the things that drive Christ's kingdom forward. And often that's through demonstrating how the gospel impacts their everyday lives.
And so then involving them in our church, what some ways can we involve them in our church today?
Sure. So, I mean, so often we think, well, we'll make Matt's little Timmy. We'll make little Timmy an usher at the door. And that's a great idea if you're expecting little Timmy's friends to come and then he's free to go sit with them so they're not alone. It's a terrible idea if, well, we have a hole in our greeter's schedule and it needs to be plugged, therefore little Timmy will be doing that. So inviting them alongside of us as we're doing the things that actually matter. We're not doing youth ministry, at least I'm not, and I don't think anybody does, so that we can raise people to populate church boards and governance policies in the future. Right? Like so if we're going to be worshiping together, let's get them to lead us in worship.
Yes.
If we're going to be sharing the gospel, let's get them equipped to share the gospel, and not just on a youth Sunday twice a quarter or whatever, but you know what? We've got, in our context, we've got a couple of worship teams. Let's not have a youth worship team. Let's make youth part of all worship teams so that they're integrated amongst the community. But then let's make sure that the primary way that youth are serving isn't necessarily inside our doors. It's down the road at the food bank, or it's, you know, at a local sports field or whatever, that they're outside of our own four walls living for the kingdom out there.
Thank you. And Nancy, what are some of the ways you involve children in your wider congregation?
Sure. There's all kinds of ways. One way is we have a socially conscious group of children, which excites me, especially being that I work with street people. And for them to be leading in some of those ministries, we have little Jonathan who comes every third Sunday to our third Sunday supper. And Jonathan is, I think he's 8, and he's been there for about a year and a half. And he comes to the door, and he and his dad, or he and his mom, open the door and welcome all of our street folks as they come in. And nice. Jonathan is now their buddy, and Jonathan does not hold anything back. If they are dressed kind of funny, he looks and says, wow, nice costume. But you know, those folks that are there, my street level guys, they love him. And if Jonathan's not there, they miss him. Jonathan fills the water pitchers as they're eating their supper. He's around making sure they've got more water. Jonathan now, when he sees them on the street, can say hi. And yeah, there's all kinds of safety things, and we put all those things in place. But for now, Jonathan, that is a place that he can serve in a practical way. And he's loving them in his own unique way. We also have children who start projects of collecting things to help the food bank or the shelter or the community health clinic. All of those things are ways. Talking globally, when they do vacation Bible schools, sending, sometimes it's hard for our kids to understand they have to pay to go to school. And they're like, well, why would you pay to go to school? It's a bit of a teaching tool, right? But for them to know of children on the other part of the world who, to get an education, they have to pay for it, and teaching them how we can give sacrificially and joyously, you know, to share that with people, and getting them part of their VBS program is collecting that money, is saving up, is giving of their money that they earn through the week, which is another teaching tool, right? But in involving them in those global opportunities, but also locally, both with pastors, but involving their families, having them serve together is a powerful thing. You know, going to a community center and helping clean up, all those things that aren't very glorious all the time, but you know, that old hymn that I absolutely love, there's joy in serving Jesus. Letting our kids see that joy that comes when we serve Jesus, and then seeing the joy that comes from them as they learn what it is to serve him.
Beautiful. You want to add something?
Yeah. I guess, you know, listening to Nancy, she helped crystallize what I was trying to say earlier, and that was, if we have to create programs for our kids to go out and live out the gospel, then maybe what needs to happen is that we need to start living out the gospel so that the kids can come with us as we do that, if that makes sense.
Together, we do it
exactly,
together.
Yeah.
Absolutely, thank you. I'm going to open it up to the floor again before I ask some more questions of you. So is there more questions from anyone here?
So the question that I have when it comes to sort of embracing children, youth, and family ministry, you know, the way that I think that we would all ideally see it is, you know, it's all one ministry in sort of three parts, you know, sort of like how the Trinity works now. just when it comes to children and youth ministry, one thing that just from past experience that I have seen so crucial is transitions between children and youth ministry. So I was wondering if you guys could elaborate on how you guys would oversee a transition from like children's ministry to youth ministry, and then youth ministry onwards. What are some strategies that you guys would use to equip these young people for these transitions, which can be a shock to the system for many of them?
As we think about that, the statistic that really is starting to boggle my mind is that we used to think about losing our youth between high school and university, and unfortunately now it's between elementary school and junior high or middle school. We're losing, we don't have to worry too much about high school at this point. We've got a big issue happening with our children as they transition into middle school or junior high. And so we have to be intentional. Just as we have to be intentional to be a welcoming church, to get people in our doors, we need to be intentional in keeping them and in helping them to serve, in them being real. Anyway, that's, I'll let Dan continue, but that's something that we have to be really intentional about.
Yeah, and so just to follow up with what Nancy just said, with those stats and those numbers, I mean, that's something that our CE board, wrestled with. And so we started an event, kind of a celebration event, a couple of years ago that we called Sunday. and it's for grade 5 students. We run our midweek kids program. This is a great outreach ministry where 75% of the kids that are involved are from the community. And so the majority of the kids in our midweek program are actually not our church kids. So what we do for our grade 5 students, we invite all the grade 5 students that are connected with our church, whether it's our Sunday morning kids or Tuesday night kids, as well as others that we can gather. And so we bring them in for a ice cream Sunday event on a Sunday afternoon in June, kind of just to say, hey, congratulations on finishing elementary school. And we use that as a way. I bring in some of my middle school and high school students to help run that event so they can get to know some of the other students. And we pass some. We give each kid who's there a teen study Bible as well as at that event. But we use it as a way to help launch them into our middle school ministry. So from there, they're invited to all of the summer youth ministry stuff that we're doing. And then I've also got a point of contact with them in the fall.
I've just been a one-year senior pastor in church. My history before that was 14 summers in summer camp ministry. I appreciate a lot what you say about silos and youth ministry and integration and all those kinds of things. I've seen firsthand what especially high school students are capable of in terms of ministry in the camp context through a summer program of running programs, evangelism, teaching, looking after maintenance, like everything that goes with all that. So fully capable. And my frustration as a camp leader was sometimes, why don't churches understand what they're capable of and why aren't they integrated in the life of the church beyond taking an offer when they can run the rest through the summer? So my question for you is, with most of us, I'm assuming a lot of us are senior pastors in the room or church leaders that are fully integrated with youth program perhaps. What would you say to senior pastors or perhaps other leaders in the church who struggle with how do we now connect youth into integration into the life of the church in terms of doing ministry with instead of just having ministry to or for?
You're holding the mic.
I knew I should have passed the mic off before that. It's so hard. I've had so many of my own students that work at camp through the summer as well. And so part of it is just, it comes to relationship and trying to find where they're gifted and trying to find ways to plug them into the life of the church. I mean, the reality too is, they're also busy, and my students have sometimes turned down invitations to serve because of academic pressures, whether it's middle school or high school, but just trying to find those giftings. So I've got a kid who is in middle school right now, and he is one of the toughest kids to have a conversation with that I've ever met. But funny kid, and so he just recently he got his brother to film a video of him cooking Mr. Noodles. And he posted it on Facebook, and it has gotten more views. I showed it to my own children, and my children come back to me and they ask, can we watch this video again of this kid cooking Mr. Noodles? And so I'm like, okay, he's just funny, so how do I use this? And so I went to him just recently, and I said, okay, next time I'm teaching our kids at seminar, I want you to help me teach the story, because I think you've got a great gift for capturing people's attention, and I want to use that. I want to use your gift in the church in this way. So I haven't done it yet. I just asked him, but he said yes. And so in a couple weeks when we do this together, we'll see how it goes. But that's an example. But I think it's got to be case by case, student by student.
And just practically for our own lives, Mitch, you and I go back a long way, and we were probably 18 and 19 when somebody let us start running the youth ministry. Which, looking back, I have occasionally asked, what are they thinking? But somehow God still used it. And so a lot of the time we need to remember that we weren't all that different. right? And frankly, I needed to get out of some of my students' way to make room for them. And I think that's probably true for a lot of us.
Advice, let them lead. Good questions.
I remember when I was a teenager, which is a long, long, long time ago, but a pastor came and asked me if I'd be willing to serve as a junior deacon, and I said yes, and that started off a journey for me. I've been thinking about this in smaller churches where there are some very young people. I wonder, their wisdom with money is greater than wisdom that adults have with money. Why can't we encourage them to be partners with the treasurer or the finance committee? Why can't we invite them to be partners in the context of the board? Why can't we get them to be partners with the trustees? If they are really the church of today, is there some reason why we can't introduce them directly into the variety of ministries that already exist? Maybe they would bring a new view to the things that would help to meet the needs that they have, as well as meet the needs that we have. I wonder if you could address that.
I think that's a great comment. I think the key thing there for me would be to you know, as you get to know your young people, as you see gifts develop there and their passions. If that's somewhere that you think that they would thrive in, something they would enjoy, and if you think that there are people in those leadership positions that can take on a junior role, I say sure, yeah, go for it. Why not? Let them try it. And very importantly to that, like you said, was if they have input, man, listen, you know, share, take what they have to say to heart, and. You know, consider how it might be helpful.
Sure. And I fully agree with that, but I think we also need to sometimes ask our questions. Ministries and the way that we do things now, are they really inherently part of the church? Or are they just our structures? And I was thinking about this on the way down, and it probably really dates me, but I can remember having to have, like, get the antenna just right on the TV so I could see the image, and then I'd learn to ignore the static. Our kids want to see the image. They want to see Christ. It's incumbent on us to reduce the amount of static that we throw in the way. And some of our church structures and policies and governance, they're very useful on a certain level, but in other ways, there's a tendency to throw some static up. And we just need to be careful not to get them involved in human structures rather than kingdom structures.
Any questions from the floor? So far, we have talked about how to integrate the youth into the adult perspective and areas of the church, but we haven't really talked about how the adults could be into their area of the churches. How can we encourage the adults to get involved more with them and what they're doing?
It's a great question. As I'm getting to know some of the culture at RiverCross and how they're serving their children, one thing that had just happened before I had arrived is that they did a curriculum overhaul, and I've noticed actually there seems to be something happening all week long. You know, we're hearing about churches who are, you know, reconsidering or reimagining Sunday school. Well, RiverCross did the same thing, and instead of having what they would call a typical Sunday school, they've actually broken up their Sunday morning programs into small groups and intentional ways of serving their children in small groups so that they can just develop relationships together and have intentional relationships with some specific adults. And I think the result that they have discovered in that is that there's a sense among the adults who are saying, oh, you know, Sunday school is fun again. You know, they're enjoying that, and they're getting connected, and they're enjoying the relationships, and there's some excitement and enthusiasm in the way that that the adults are getting involved, and I think it's contagious, and so I guess just seeing the fruit of deep relationships happening, and seeing significant life change in the lives of the children is attractive to adults, and they're wanting to get involved in those kinds of relationships with our kids.
As I said, I have a generation of children that I'm seeing are definitely more socially conscious than their parents, which would be my generation. We're very selfish, and it's all about me and what I want. And when I think of these children as I'm watching them grow, and they're thinking about the Ebola crisis, and they're really concerned about that, and we pray about that. And when they're concerned about the homeless people, when it's this cold outside, where do they go? What happens if they have children? It's those questions that are taking me and our leaders and bringing them to the children's level that is forcing us to be involved with them. And they are leading us, and they're taking us not down to their level, they're taking us really, I think, to where God is and what he's doing and what he wants us to do. So I think, again, it's listening. And we have a very special generation in our churches right now that have a lot to say and a lot to take us and take our perspectives off ourselves and back to where it needs to be.
That brings a very practical question to my mind. Whether you're a small church or a large church, we sometimes struggle to get volunteers. So, any advice in terms of getting volunteers?
Can I answer?
Yeah, absolutely. Let me bring your mic. Don has advice.
I'm in a small church just outside of Sussex in North, and it was my wife and I who were the youth leaders this year, and she's now part of the St. John Track Club with my son. And so there I am by myself. I have nobody else to be a youth group leader with. And so I thought, what are we going to do? I set up a rotation. I have four families that once 1 week a month, because there's usually 4 weeks in a month, except for March, but, you know, then there's March break, and you don't have youth group on March break, right? So there's 4 weeks. So I have a couple that come in the first week. I have a lady who comes in the second week, another lady for the third week, and another couple the last week. So it's a rotation. And I said to one of the leaders, she says, what do I need to do? I said, all I want you to do is show up, build relationships with these kids. You mean I don't have to plan anything? No. Just come, be part of, you know, the group, and, you know, hang out. She was just so relieved that she didn't have to plan anything, that she just had to show up and relationship develop. So that's one way to utilize some of your people and not overwhelm them with, oh, I got to be there every week for the whole works, you know, once a month, and it works well for them.
And that's where we get flexibility in different schedules, different rotations, and realizing people's schedules look very different today. Anyone want to add to volunteer? This is because you're not alone.
Yeah.
If you don't mind, I'd like to make some observations about that small church that has two children, because that's our church. Two children, same family, 3 years old and 1 year old. And what I have found is that it's my interaction with the children through the week that makes the real difference in building that ministry. They're not quite into social media like our high elementary or mid-school kids are. They still go to the mailbox to get mail. And they are really, really excited when a letter comes with their name on it. It's actually stamped and delivered by the mail lady. So that tells them that they're important. There's some other things that we like to do. I like to offer to babysit so the parents can have their date night once in a while.
that get more out of the children's story than the kids. And the children, and it's all right if they run up the aisle and make a little noise. Let's celebrate that they have life in them. Isn't that wonderful? So just my comment is that in having a program with them, their children's church, I try to have at least a Bible truth that goes along with the pastor's message so that they have something to share if their parents start talking about what the pastor said at church. They have a little picture or something that helps them be part of their family conversation. And we love to have music. We dance to Jesus Loves Me. This Little Light of Mine, we dance because that's part of their worship for them. And I just want to say that I think if we want our young families to stay, then church has to be home. Thanks.
Thank you so much for sharing. Very good practical ideas. And just to encourage you, you're from a rural church. I was part of a city church, and we took a group of students that only knew the city on a mission tour called Title Impact to a very rural church. And the rural church was terrified because they were all seniors, and they were very small. We outnumbered them in coming. And they had one teenager that was a grandson of somebody in the church. And they were terrified, and our teenagers were terrified. What were they going into this rural community with seniors? By the time we left at the end of the week, the teenagers did not want to leave. They raved about the food that the seniors fed them in the rural community. They raved about how they would get home at the end of the day, and those seniors would have hot chocolate ready for them, and they'd sit down and want to hear about their day. And the seniors didn't want them to leave at the end of the week either. And, so don't underestimate the power of those relationships. Melissa, saw your hand.
Really have to know our stuff, and we need to be digging deeper in our faith, and they need to see us wrestling with those things and those questions and how it changes our lives. And I think we need to be not just, and I'm as guilty as the next one, not just rushing and throwing something together, but let's think this through. Let's give them some meat, not just the baby food. Let's really give them something to chew on, and something that may take us a while, you know, to get. That's not something we can solve in half an hour, but over a month or something, we're going to study one thing and really know it and know it well. And again, I think they need to see the difference that Jesus makes in our lives and the difference he makes in how we respond to these crises that are happening around our world.
I don't have a question. I just a couple of children in our church. This little fellow, 6 years old, came to me and said, "Pastor, could I go in the choir?" I said, "Sure. There's a seat right up there." He got up there. He had just got a pair of new glasses on. He's watching. Pointing to the glasses. "Look at him. I got new glasses." And then another little fellow, he's 4 years old. And just before I sent him down to Sunday school, I always had prayer with him. At Christmas, I was emphasizing with gifts. All your kids are going to get a lot of gifts. But the most important gift is Jesus. So his mother was telling me one day, they were on their way home, and she was frustrated. "Well, somebody should have got to get a gift for." And this little fellow says, "Well, Mommy, Christmas isn't about giving, it's about Jesus." So you see, children do listen, and they can teach us a lot of things.
Yes, they can bring such life to our congregations. Any other questions?
Curriculum and very similar to the one that we're currently using at Douglas,
And so I was just able to answer some of those questions. But we got connected because she first contacted the convention office. And so there's another opportunity for networking, because Renée and her team can help connect us as well as with questions.
Yeah, I just want to add to that by saying I hold churches that are trying to do these things, you know, entirely volunteer-led, I hold those churches to the highest regard. I have no idea how you do it. And I'm so thankful that you're trying and you're fighting tooth and nail, and that, you know, we've been talking about hope, and we've been talking about, you know, the heart that we have for seeing people come to know Jesus. And I would ask you, you know, never mind networking, but please, you know, teach me how you're doing it, and what are you doing to do what you can. You know, you're working all day, you're showing up at night, you're volunteering, you know, 3 hours on Sunday, and so, you know, whatever those things, those small little opportunities that you have to invest into the lives of young people, how are you maximizing those moments is something I would love to learn from. And I'm so thankful for the churches who are not giving up on that.
Well, you mentioned it before, but it's worth mentioning again, is the Facebook groups, where there's all kinds of sharing going on there, questions and sharing resources and ideas. So it's kind of great sharing stuff. Another question?
Hi, I'm a pastor, a senior pastor of a small church. And so one of the things that I want to ask you was this, like, in particular, right? My son, I'm sitting in my office, my son texts me, he's president of student council in high school, and he texts me, and this was his text, he says, "Why do church people hate homosexuals?" Okay? And to which my first response was, "Why are you asking?" then we have a conversation later. And I don't want you to answer that question. But this is my question that kind of goes along with that. How do you work with young people whose culture is much different than the most of the congregation, but the way in which they see the older congregation deal with issues like homosexuality, come across as hating those people? How do you teach your youth when they don't see it being active in much broader congregations? Do you sort of know what I mean?
Yeah. Great, thank you. If we have people in our church that are hateful, we've got a completely different context. When I'm dealing with my teens and my young adults around this issue, I get them to go to Scripture and not form their own conclusions, but to study Scripture, study good literature, to spend time in prayer about it, but then also to check their level of love. And if they're doing it so that they can say you're right or you're wrong or anything like that, that's almost a losing position to start from. If they're doing it so they can carry the gospel in a way that makes our King proud, That's the starting point for that question. Just because we haven't done it well before, and I'm not saying we have, but we have, a completely different issue, doesn't mean that we can't do it well now and in the future. Yeah.
Going around Atlantic Canada doing a number of dialogues and forums, helping
I got to say, we do start from a cultural deficit. I was sitting in something like this, you know, five or six teenagers and a couple of youth pastors in Maine. I arrived late, and my colleague said, and this is Micah, he's from the Baptist church, and one of the teens looked at me and went, oh, you're the homophobes. And I was like, I didn't think so. But have we behaved in such a way that we've earned the title? I hope not.
I don't think that maybe I didn't phrase it right. It wasn't necessarily to that topic.
Yeah.
My topic is how do you deal with the youth on certain issues like that?
Yeah.
That they don't see it being lived out in the body of Christ in the rest of the congregation. So whatever issue it might be.
Sure.
So
social justice or anything like that.
As you're teaching it to them, they aren't seeing it lived out, so they're like, well, if that's the way, then why do all these other people? And I'm just wondering how you deal with that.
Yeah, I'll only say one thing more, and then I'll hand off the mic. And it would be to model it yourself, right? And not to look at other people and say, well, yeah, no, they did do it wrong. But to keep pointing them back to themselves and say, how is Jesus going to make his way in your life at this point? And to stop... to cut, nip in the bud the tendency that we all have to judge other people.
And it comes back to what Nancy said earlier about being real. And sometimes we just have to be upfront with our students and say, you know what, we've gotten it wrong. As a church, we've made mistakes. And we have to be honest with them. And so I've had those conversations with my students. And to try to address these topics from a place where it's more of a conversation, so they can ask the question, and they can dialogue, and they can be involved in the conversation, and to say, yeah, you know what, you're right. As a church, we have not done well at this, but this is what Jesus says. This is the standard that we're to hold to. So how do we, as a group sitting around this table right now, how do we address this? And it's just, yeah, being honest with them, being real with them, and admitting that sometimes we make mistakes, and that's okay. Because I think we're afraid to admit that, but.
Thing that I was saying about how congregations can celebrate celebrate together some significant milestones of faith, and in our young people, as we see them grow up and as we see them come to know Jesus and make decisions to follow him. I think there's an incredible, I mean, we've all had the privilege of celebrating, you know, baptism and new life in our congregations, and, you know, we've had the opportunities to see that happen. In our young people especially, the powerful stories of young people who have gone through situations in their lives where it would have made much more sense to walk away from faith, draw even closer and rely on him, and have made decisions to use that as an anchor, I think are very, very powerful. So yeah, it's certainly a challenge to help people come alongside them and, you know, invest in them, help them to see how God might be working and stirring in their lives, but certainly an opportunity to celebrate as a congregation too when those moments do happen.
I'd like us to end by thinking about signs of hope. So what signs of hope do you see from our children and youth?
For me, one of the greatest signs of hope that I'm seeing is in my students really wanting to engage their faith in how they live. So it's not just about socially aware. But even as I have kids, we just had a baptism a couple weeks ago at our church, and after that I had a kid who, grade 4 I think, who came up to me and said, "I want to be baptized." And it's those moments like that that are really, really encouraging and really give a sense of hope. And the other thing too, this is going to sound cliche, but I think the other sign of hope that I think we need to hold on to is a source of our hope, which is Christ. I had a conversation on Sunday night with a woman from our church in my living room, and she loves Jesus and really wants to love the church, but is just so discouraged by what she sees in just institutional church in general. And yet, the reason that I have hope in the church is because this is who Jesus has called us to be. And so my hope is in Christ, and I think as long as we continue to follow Christ and to seek what it means to live as Christ followers in our communities, then that is hope as well. But I'm definitely seeing it in our students and our kids as they're trying to be authentic and living good.
God is alive, well, and would you join me in thanking our panelists this afternoon? Would you stand with me as we pray?
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are a great and mighty God. You are mighty to save. You are mighty to work among us. You are mighty to continue to call people by name. You are mighty to make sure that they recognize your voice amongst all the voices in our world. You are mighty to free them from the other things that will hold them. You are mighty to build your church. You are mighty to reveal yourself in small ways and big ways. You are mighty to use the voice of a child to point us in the way we should go. You're mighty to use youth to bring change, bring change where we need it in our hearts, to bring change where we need it in our community, change where we need it in our church. God, today we say we believe in you. We believe in your power to use your people, young, old, and everywhere in between, to build your kingdom. And so we pray together, your kingdom come here on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name. And they all said,
amen.
Amen. Thank you, everyone.